your feet.
Good afternoon. My name is Bruce Dean. I'm a single disabled father, student, artist, writer, and photographer with an extensive family background in the oilfield industry from Alberta and Texas primarily. Many years ago, our family invented continuous sucker rod and all the related servicing equipment known as co-rod manufacturing back then. And I don't know if you know sucker rods, the rod that was up and down in the well, and usually it's in 25 foot lengths, I think. I'm the one from a non-oil member of my family. And my family figured out how to make it long in schools and stuff like that. So as time passed, the oil industry aspect of our business focus moved toward one of the weak points in the pursuit of fossil fuels, disasters. There proved to be much money in attempts to prevent equipment failures that proved costly to those investing in fossil fuels. Back then, there was an even less concern for the environmental impact than there was today, or there is today. It was more concern for financial loss that motivated the non-destructive testing. In particular, our business focused upon flaw detection through non-destructive testing of steel products specializing in the real-time production line flaw detection of tubular products because pipelines fail. Because pipelines fail is one of the reasons I'm here. I'm also here because I'm an outdoor enthusiast. Often I'm restricted to access to nature because of overpriced inadequate parks and green spaces that now require reservations and significant expendable income to visit. Often I'm restricted to access to nature because of rules that greatly limit access for mountain bikes. Yet some greedy guys with no concern for the environment want to thrust a pipeline just waiting to fail through our entire province and then cruise potential environmental disasters called supertankers through our waters. How does that work? You know, supertanker, no problem, mountain bike, no? There's something very wrong with our priorities here and our perspective. Another reason why I'm here is because I'm a sailor. Sailing World magazine archives have a feature article about me sailing in our renowned global waters on my beach class catamaran. I know that even the best sailor could hit the rocks buried beneath the surface or misjudge the tides and currents. Supertankers cruising through our world-famous sailing waters and islands is a fool's game for profit in the name of fossil fuels, nothing else. Restricting my access to Mother Nature because my mountain bike's knobby tires might disturb some tree roots but allowing pipelines and supertankers through our woods and waters? I don't understand how that works. It's corporations' desires ahead of individual needs. It's corporations' desires ahead of environmental needs. It's akin to the restrictions upon my ability to even fly fish while corporations profit from and deplete the ocean's bounty. Again, the mismatch there. I should be able to fish year-round, and the corporation should have to go without fishing if the fish stocks are low. How could it work around? That's just silliness. Another reason I'm here is I'm an environmentalist. And somehow, on my below-poverty-line disability income and living in pain 24/7, I was able to develop an environmentally-friendly vehicle mobility aid for myself. If you want, you can read about it in the current issue of Momentum magazine, issue 59. So what is the problem with my government and our corporations? Why am I leading them in the charge to save our environment? I'm just a broke, kimped-up single dad. This project will have a negative impact on me because it signifies a continued focus upon fossil fuels. Obviously misguided to even the most clueless. This project will have a negative impact on me because, as a Canadian, it's embarrassing to be associated with a country with such destructive views on the environment. It's embarrassing to be associated with a country that continues to treat our indigenous population with such disrespect, contempt, and indifference. There is no justification to bully our way through with a pipeline when all efforts to reconcile long-standing issues with indigenous people have been inadequate. Why the rush for oil when the indigenous people wait? Again, I don't understand what's with that. This project will have a negative impact on me because, as a disabled worker thrust into poverty because of my on-the-job injury, I see efforts and financial resources that could help BC's many poor and impoverished instead diverted and focused to ensure profits for a corporation for a project with such evident and strong public objection. I was asked by the Joint Review Panel for my views on whether the project is in the public interest. What a silly question that is. The answer is, of course not. This pipeline project is in the interest of a few rich who the public do not need. Those rich could all die in a tragic horse polo event for charity with a pip pip and a cheerio, nothing would change. If investors' money is not put into this project or another fossil fuel project, it would be put into the next most profitable venture for them so their money can make more money and they can still become even richer. I prefer those rich greedhead investors to get rich off environmentally friendly and renewable resources such as wind farms, solar power, pedal power, marijuana hemp farms, whatever. whether we're talking fossil fuels, tar sands, or heavy bitumen oil, how do you pronounce it, bitumen, I'm not too sure, but anyways, that the ugly oil that we have to pump through our pipelines and whatnot and modify just a little flow through the pipelines, apparently, from what I understand. And an oil tanker, to give us a perspective, an oil tanker can hold about 200 to 500,000 barrel of oil somewhere in there. Obviously, there's a lot of variation depending upon the ship. One barrel of oil equals about 672 cups of oil. Right here, this is like about a cup of oil right there.
Mr. Dean, would you please put that back in your pocket? There are no visual aids allowed other than what's on paper.
Well, that's not what I read in the directions. It didn't. It said it discouraged visual aids. It didn't sound that no visual aids were allowed.
It just goes on paper is what's allowed. Thank you.
Well, they said you prefer to have it, but it didn't say it wasn't allowed, so.
Boom, 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 I'm gonna shoot you right down. Red all for your feet.
Okay, so we're changing the rules right here?
If you want to check the procedural direction, it's been very clear, Mr. Keith.
Yeah, okay, yeah, I printed off at home too, so I read through it, so. Okay, well, and I guess the reason I have to have my visual aid in my pocket is because fear of it, the dirty mess it could create. I got one little cup of oil that I brought to show here, okay? Picture a lineup of people, a quarter billion people, with that cup of oil that I wasn't even allowed to show here in a protective bag, you know, closed up, and whatever. And we're all worried about that in this meeting room here. Picture a lineup of a quarter billion people, each with their own baggie, going to your favorite stream, your favorite river, your favorite lake, even your, and if you don't have it, if you're not a nature lover, maybe even in the front seat of your car. How many people out of that quarter billion lineup would you allow to dump that oil into your car or into your river or lake before you stopped it and said, this is madness? Yet we keep pursuing fossil fuels, and you keep having the spills and the pipeline breaks that make my family rich. And not me, my family. And we wouldn't let. We would be with one person maybe, and you'd realize that the rest of the lab's there to do that. You'd be like, no, this isn't allowed. So that's the individual, we'll stop, whatever. But the corporations, no problem at all. We can't even show a bag of oil in this room here for demonstration purposes. But yet, we are considering putting a pipeline through. That's all I've got, thanks.